How does exercise help diabetes? You've all heard the cliche statements on exercise already. It's good for the heart. It helps control body weight, blah, 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 blah. You know this already. Today, I'm going to enlighten you, give you a completely different view on the human body and how to fight diabetes through this newly gained knowledge. I've said in previous episodes, being diagnosed as a diabetic can be a blessing. What? All the pain and suffering we go through? How so? I will explain that today. As an added bonus, at the end, I will let you on my big secret. The most powerful tool in my arsenal that drives up my insulin sensitivity for the day. Helps keep my A1C in the low fives, and at the same time keeps me lean, in and around the 8% body fat range, even though I am an insulin-using, insulin-dependent diabetic. But before we begin, let me welcome all those brand new resilient diabetics out there. This is where we turn ordinary struggling diabetics into extraordinary well-controlled diabetics. If you don't know who I am, let me introduce myself to you. My name is Jay Sampat, and I am an insulin-dependent diabetic diagnosed a little over 5 years ago. So the proud owner of a pancreas that seems to have gone on a permanent and lifelong vacation. So not only am I diabetic, like you, where we'll be walking that walk and talking that talk together, but I do also have a Bachelor of Science degree in nutrition dietetics, and that does come in very handy in discussing all the intricacies of being a diabetic. The unique information presented today will only be found here on The Resilient Diabetic. So if you want to learn more, then I highly suggest you do hit that subscribe button, that like button, and the notification icon, which is the gray bell. That is so you don't miss a second of any of the upcoming episodes that will change your life. So to begin, we first have to rewind on a few things. How was the human body fueled and fed prior to, say, the 1900s? One must understand the human body was first designed to move. It's built, hardwired into our DNA. We moved and we were in motion all day long. And that physical activity was expanded to gain and acquire one thing, food. So one basically ate accordingly to fuel the body for the whole day. Past generations had to hunt and gather, or in modern society, they had to walk to work. They had to walk home. They had to tend to the farm. They had to work throughout the day without any of the modern comforts. Physical manual labor was the cornerstone of humankind from day one. From the second one got up from bed until they went to sleep, they were basically in motion. So they could and they had to eat things like breads, pastas, potatoes, and rice because those foods fuel the body throughout the day. Prior generations did not get up, eat a bowl of oatmeal, bread, milk, juice, get into the car, drive to work, then probably take the elevator up, only to then eat more carbohydrate snacks, probably some more drinks, sit in front of the computer for a couple more hours, then get back into the car, go have lunch somewhere, and that probably included a sandwich and some chips and a drink, more carbs. And then drive back to work, eat some more carbs through some snacks, drive back home, have a heavy dinner that included more carbs, then sit on the couch and probably binge fest a little Netflix show while eating another carbohydrate-based dessert. So essentially, what is the body to do with all that extra carbohydrates coming in day after day when the body's fuel sources are full because there is no physical activity? And does it really matter if the carbohydrates are quote-unquote healthy whole grains if one is not using it for energy? And this is where the lessons of diabetes begins regardless of type. Once carbohydrates are consumed in excess, and again, it doesn't really matter whether it comes from a can of soda or a bowl of rice or even whole grain breads, the body now has to find a place to store it. And because it's not being used due to inactivity, our stores are basically full already. So what does it do? It converts those carbs into fat and then stores it in places the human body was not really designed for, in between body organs, inside muscle tissue, in the liver, up and around the belly area. This specific fat then in turn or creates what's known as resistance for insulin, meaning that this fat makes insulin worthless. So the body has to continually make more and more and more insulin to help lower blood sugars. And this deadly cycle continues until that breaking point occurs. You're either diagnosed as a diabetic or your diabetes just gets worse. So, how is being diagnosed as a diabetic a blessing? Well, unlike other diseases where you have no control over death, further complications, and related diseases, thus a lot of suffering, our bodies, once diagnosed, have basically essentially shown us our cards. No other disease allows for this. It is communicating back to us, we can either live a full, long, healthy life or begin this downward spiral of extreme health issues. Everyone else, depending on their disease, will be caught completely off guard. Your body wants to live, and it's sending you the signs and signals of what it wants and what is actually directly killing it. It has given you this crossroads or a choice. Take it or leave it. Point blank, what is it saying? Our bodies cannot continue to consume all these carbohydrates, good or bad. So basically, cut it back and get physically moving. So the diabetic experts out there, they really scare me for two reasons. One, they still promote all the excessive consumption of carbohydrates, even the healthy ones, in a society that no longer is in motion or is physically active. And if you have not noticed, that includes our children too. Two, the experts who do promote a lower carbohydrate intake but ignore the other factor, our hardwired DNA that needs to move and to be physically active. Being physically active or exercise does have many benefits. But the biggest one, the most important one to us diabetics, it makes it easier to control our blood sugars. Exercise or being physically active can reduce the glucose in the blood because muscles can use that glucose directly for energy. In other words, it doesn't matter if you're insulin resistant or you don't have enough insulin. When you exercise, your muscles get glucose they need, and in turn, your blood glucose levels go down over time. If you are insulin resistant, exercise can actually make your insulin more efficient. I have said, and I will continue to say, we want two things as a diabetic. One, we want blood sugars within that very healthy range throughout the day. Two, and most importantly, to keep insulin levels low and controlled. It is the high levels of insulin released by our bodies, or that has to be taken continuously due to the overconsumption of carbohydrates, that is causing much of the inflammation and the health issues. But insulin, as I've mentioned before, is not the evil hormone here that it's made out to be. It is still necessary for recovery, for replenishment, and that is to heal the body and remain healthy. Now, I will go into details in another episode of how exercise lowers blood sugar. And for some, I'll explain the paradox of why it actually goes up during certain times. But for now, all I need you to think about is just getting more active. When most people are diagnosed with diabetes, the idea of exercising becomes particularly daunting and sometimes overwhelming at first. Sometimes you just don't know where to begin. But before you do, you should always talk to your doctor first. Your doctor will need to check your heart health, which is important if you already have blocked arteries or you have high blood pressure. You also need to take into account the other considerations of diabetes-related complications, such as retinopathy or neuropathy. Your doctor can refer you to an exercise physiologist or a diabetes educator to help figure out the best exercise program that allows you to get in shape for your fitness level. If you decide to begin exercising, you need to set up realistic goals. If you haven't exercised much, you will need to start off really slowly and gradually increase the amount of intensity and activity. Do you need to be training 6 days a week like me to reverse many of the symptoms of being diabetic? Absolutely not. If you haven't been active recently, you can actually just start out with 5 to 10 minutes a day, then increase your activity sessions by a few minutes each week. For example, you might take a brisk 10-minute walk after each meal, or you could try doing 15 minutes of aerobics in the morning before you go to work, and maybe another 15 minutes when you get home. The goal here is to just get physically active to help pull those glucose-resistant fat cells that are causing a lot of the damage. That activity will also make your insulin you produce to be a lot more effective, so your body needs less, thus less inflammation. I want you to find an activity you love. Maybe you or your wife or your husband, that you guys love to dance. So take some ballroom dancing classes a few times a week instead of sitting on the couch. If you like to swim, do so. In other words, replace some time sitting idly for something you enjoy physically. So what is my secret weapon that helps keep me lean and fit outside of the gym? My other love. I call him Mr. Treadmill. The single most important weapon I have in increasing sensitivity. Every morning, I go to my garage, get on my treadmill, and I walk. Yes, a simple walk for 30 minutes, and I love it. It's really easy on the body, and I feel great after. My settings on my treadmill, I'll give that to you. I get in an angle of about 2 and a speed of about 3.5 to about 3.8 miles per hour. That's it. I do my cardio first thing in the morning, fasted, on an empty stomach with just a cup of coffee in me. I then do weight for a couple hours before I have my first meal. So in other words, I stay a little bit fasted, allowing my body to use the fats for energy before I have my first meal. That, folks, is one of the most powerful tools in my arsenal I am giving to you today. I will set up a playlist for you. In that playlist, you will find more videos that will definitely help you be that healthy, energetic diabetic. In the video, are smoothies, fruits healthy for diabetics? There will be a discussion on how carbohydrates are broken down and utilized by the body. It will be your base of knowledge on carbohydrate metabolism. Videos on insulin. Does it really make you fat? Metformin, what are the latest studies on that? Your doctor and your doctor's limitations. What about the simple things like oatmeal? Can we as diabetics eat oatmeal for breakfast? I'll create a link for you right there. If you're on your desktop or laptop, use your mouse to click that box. If you're on your mobile device, click that with your finger. So have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another episode, which I've said before, are always released weekly. Bye for now.